morning, everybody. Thank you for coming out to our Peace Pole Ceremony panel of students who are brave enough to be up here speaking about different issues and aspects of violence, whether it be bullying, racism, sexism, domestic violence, sexual assault. We're going to talk about a bunch of different things here today. So thank you all for coming and supporting them. I would first like to introduce to you Mr. Ryan Kirby. He's our Attleboro Student Senate representative, and he has worked very hard on a spoken word poem that he is going to present to you.
Hello, thank you. So this is titled, An Open Letter to America's Children. The world is yours, but do not be mistaken. The world is not just yours. The world is everyone's. So love everyone in the world. Love anyone in the world. Love the world. Love using the word love. Replace every other word with it so that everything that comes out of your mouth will be loving. It will teach you to be loving without lying and teach you to love without trying. And every breath that you take and every step that you make will be aimed at a place. A place where everyone stands together with no thoughts that aren't loving and no actions that aren't caring. A place where nobody's afraid to go to school. Nobody is afraid of a bully or of seeing their attacker or of facing discrimination or of being alone with the teacher, where nobody is beat to the ground or put down because of who they are. A place where nobody aims a gun at you and a place where nobody aims a gun at themselves because nobody feels like they have to. A place where everyone feels safe walking the streets and everyone feels safe at home. A place where everyone feels safe holding hands with their partner. A place where everyone feels safe being who they are. A place where everyone feels safe. Thank you.
Thank you for that, Ryan. I would now like to introduce to you Mr. Trot Joseph Lee, and he has a nice speech prepared for us.
I actually don't have a speech prepared because I feel like speaking from your heart for your mind, sometimes it becomes more genuine when you're able to do these kind of things, especially when you're talking about peace, you're talking about trying to combat certain things like racism, sexism, classism, which is, in my opinion, the root of all of it. Looking at the politics and look what's going on in the world today, with all the, you know, back and forth and all the different agendas that are going around, the one thing that, in my opinion, persists or would help us through all these things is tolerance. You can have your own personal views on life. You don't even have to like each other. You really don't. You're not obligated to like one another. You're obligated, though, to be peaceful with each other. You're obligated to respect the other person's individual rights and individual liberty. You're obligated to allow somebody to exist on the side of you without physical harm or any other kind of harm. And tolerance is the path that gets you there, to tolerate that someone else can have a different point of view, have different skin color, have different sexual orientations. That's where you find your path to peace, and that's our obligation. So if you ever see that level of intolerance in your area or around you, you let that person know. You know what? That person has a right to be who they want to be. They have the right to dress the way they want to dress. They have a right to talk the way they want to talk. You're the person that needs to look at yourself and say, am I the tolerant one? Am I the one that's leading by example? Thank you.
Thank you, Trot. Now we're going to move forward with our student panel. Just to go over the format, I'm going to ask a question, and whoever would like to answer the question will raise their hand. We only have one mic, so we have to kind of do that system. I would like to start with the panel introducing themselves.
Good early afternoon, everyone. My name is Christopher Burrow. I am on the Student Senate. I am also the New Bedford campus representative as well as the public relations officer. This is my final semester here at BCC. I'll be graduating in June with my associate's degree in business admin, general management.
My name is Anthony Sumito.
My major is criminal justice, and next semester will be my last.
Hi guys, I'm Evie Robinson. I'm the Student Senate Secretary and Office Manager. This is my last semester. I'm going to UMass Dartmouth to study human relations and public administration.
Hi everybody, my name is Victoria Ferreira, and I'm currently enrolled in BCC, and I'm in a criminal justice major, and I will plan to transfer to UMass, and I only plan for success for BCC. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Brooke Duby. I am the president of the Dream Club, my major human service.
Hi everyone, my name is Caroline Macedo, though everyone calls me Lion. I'm the president of the Hero Club here at BCC, and I'm also in the psychology program.
Hi everybody, my name is Bruce Camara. I am a student here, it's my last semester, I'm gonna be transferring to Roger Williams. I study criminal justice, and I'm also gonna be going for psychology. I am a US Marine Corps veteran. One of my buddies over there. Thank you very much. Yeah. And I love BCC. It's been doing a lot for me in my future. So thank you.
Thank you, everybody. So we're going to start with the first question. So anybody that would like to answer, just raise your hand and you'll get the mic. How do you feel you can personally encourage understanding?
I feel that I can personally encourage understanding just by every day what I do, you know, speak to everybody as if they were equal. Never hold myself at a higher echelon than anybody else because we're all students here, we're all going for the same thing. And also out in public, you know, people have jobs just like you and they do what they have to do every day. It doesn't matter what skin color they are, who they are, you know, male, female, gay, straight, it doesn't matter.
Thank you, Bruce.
I feel like everybody, including myself, can encourage understanding by continuing to learn about everything. If you find there's something that you don't understand, look it up and learn about it, and try not to judge anything, even if it's not something that you don't agree with personally for yourself.
Thank you. For me, understanding starts with listening, and not just any listening, active listening. We, throughout our lives, we are based off of communication. That is our society. That is how we deal with each other. We communicate. And by communicating to each other, in order to officially understand someone else, you need to be an active listener and to actually listen to what the person is saying instead of just listening.
Anybody else? Okay. Let's move on to the second question. What does peace mean to you?
I think peace is like something like everybody should get along, like don't hate anybody, don't be racist, just like get understand. Like if you don't like them, at least you still have a peace to understand where they might come from. So.
Peace to me means that there's no judgment or aggressive micro-expressions when somebody looks at another person, or there's no violence, even if it's not physically, there's no violence mentally or emotionally, and peace to me is something that we need more of, definitely.
I would also like to add that peace should be somewhere that is safe, where you can feel at one. You don't have to get along with the person beside you or the person next door, but it's one thing to be civil with that person. So I think that peace should be calm. It should be something that you can feel surrounded in a safe spot. So that to me is peace.
Peace for me means freedom from anxiety, whether you suffer from anxiety or depression or whether there are things in the world that make you feel anxious about just living your life. For example, I said earlier at the Peace Poll dedication that I sometimes think about it and I'm afraid to send my kids to school because of all the shootings. So peace would be a world without school shootings. Peace would be a world without bombings. Peace would be being able to go on the subway and not being afraid that that would be the day that you would die. And I think that in this world, anxiety isn't just something that people suffer from as like a mental illness. It's something that we as a culture have now because there's so much fear. So a peaceful world would be one without anxiety.
Peace to me is honestly to live with all diversities, different races, ethnicities, and to accept everyone's differences and to live peacefully and interact with one another. Because that's the only way peace is achieved. If you have walls blocked of perception and misconception, that's only going to keep you jaded in your only way of life and your circle where you live around of your friends, your family. If you interact, the world is so much more to you. That's what peace is to me.
And peace for me is just simply in one word, acceptance. Being accepted of someone else's orientation, their color, their creed, their gender identity, their age, their culture, their income level. Just being accepted of someone else and who they are as a person is what peace is to me.
Those are some great answers. Next question. Do you think peace is missing from the world?
First off, I think there's already peace in the world. It's just actually trying to find it and to actually open it and let it show. A lot of people, I believe, are afraid to show their acceptance, to show their peace for another. Just in the culture that we are always in competition with each other. We're trying to get the best job out there. We're trying to, you know, get into that top-notch school so that we can be better and better ourselves. And then sometimes we sit there and we ignore it and we don't pay attention to peace. We put that aside just because of our own self-interest. So in a sense, peace is already there. We already have peace within us. It's just, you know, our own mindset that's stopping us and from really experiencing what peace is really about.
I have to agree with you, Chris, on that one. I see so much goodness and happiness and love in the world, and I'm generally a really positive person and I try and focus on positivity. So when I see like a really happy moment, I internalize that. And that's what I think about when horrible things happen. You know, when you see somebody just buy somebody else a coffee at Dunkin' Donuts and spend that $3 on somebody else that they don't have to do. And when you see the lines of people volunteering for different BCC events and soup kitchens and a lot of the Walk for Hunger stuff that we do, like, you see volunteering and you see people making a small difference in each other's lives and you know that there's peace in the world. It's just you turn on the news and there's no peace there. And I think that there's a big disconnect for a lot of people. You know, you need to turn off your TV. There are horrible things, but there's a lot of peace and a lot of goodwill in person-to-person interactions as well.
I definitely agree with both of what you guys said. Definitely true. But I do feel like if more people interacted with the word peace and actually emphasize of what it was, I think more people who got together would find peace and they would learn how to find it. If we had people like us and people like you, I'm sure you guys have your own definition of peace and what it is. But I think that if we did all come together and we show other people what peace is, I think that'll bring more people to that spot and it'll bring more peace to the world. So that's what I think.
That's it, nobody else? All right, moving on. If you could speak to someone who was prejudiced against you, what would you say to them?
No, you haven't. Okay, all right, so here's what I have to say. If someone's prejudiced towards me, I'm not here in the world, I'm not put on this earth for everyone to like me. It's impossible for everyone to like me. There's gonna be somebody that's not gonna like me, and it is what it is. I don't really wanna be around a person who's prejudiced around me, but I would really like a good explanation, and I would like a chance to explain myself of why you're prejudiced against me. I just don't know why somebody would be, but you know, there's a lot of people in the world who are. They have different opinions, they're brought up with different values, they have different morals. So my question to them would be, why would you want to be prejudiced towards me? What do you have against me? So I wouldn't want to participate again with somebody who's prejudiced against me, but I would definitely would like the chance to explain myself, and I would like to know why they're prejudiced towards me.
I agree with you, but usually if somebody prejudices me, I only wonder why, but then I'm like, you know what, a waste of time. I know I'm better than them, so I usually just walk away and find something to make me calm down and make me feel happy, so yeah.
I tend to disagree. I love to debate. I'll argue with anybody, but if somebody doesn't like me, they just don't like me, so I just move on. You know, I don't really have a specific religion, and I'm, you know, white. I don't deal with racism towards me. But if I was to come across someone who had misconceptions about sexual assault or domestic violence, which are things that I have a lot of experience in my life, I would feel sorry that they are ignorant enough to believe some of the things that they believe about sexual assault victims and victims of domestic violence. And I think that helping people learn on a greater scale through events and through different ideas and sharing ideas is a better way to combat ignorance rather than a person-to-person confrontation. Why don't you like me? Why do you think that this or this was, you know, my fault, or you know, whatever. I think that a person-to-person confrontation is just going to make people angrier, and it doesn't really solve problems. So if I was to speak to someone who was prejudiced against me, I would probably just say, you know what, have a nice day. I'm sorry you feel that way. And I would just move on with my life.
Myself, personally, I think prejudice is stupid for the most part. So I tend to not deal with stupidity, so I would tell the person that directly. I'm very open and I don't hold back on my emotions. Also, I'm a person that goes a lot with, you know, facts, so I'd want to know why. Do they not like people with hats? You know, that might be it. So so if they have a good reason not to like me, that's fine. That's their opinion. You know, you can't hold that, you know, against yourself. You know, I know that I'm a good person, and I'm going to try to voice my opinion about how I'm good to them, and if they still don't like me, that's fine. You just can't let it get to you. You got to move on, and every day is a new day. That's what I believe.
Well, personally, throughout my whole life, I've had to deal with prejudice because I'm pansexual and I'm non-binary, gender fluid, and as everyone knows, there's been lots of violence in the LGBTQ plus community, and it's something that's really rough, but what I've always tried to do is not get mad at people who are prejudiced against me because of how they were raised or how their family's religion is or what have you, but I would want to try and understand. I'd ask why, and maybe even try to help them understand where I'm coming from and what I'm about. But I find that how you're raised and your religion, whatever excuse it is, it's not any excuse for prejudice. You should always try to learn about what you don't like, even if it's something that you're really against.
I honestly wouldn't ask a why, because there's clearly no why. I tell them, sorry you feel that way, that's your loss.
How have you helped other people overcome prejudice?
Well, as I just said, I'm pansexual and gender fluid. I have actually had to help people in my own family understand and overcome certain ideas and ideas of how the LGBTQ community is. And what I try and do is just help them understand and have empathy and see where they're coming from, but also just help them find a source of understanding for these kinds of things. And also patience with people. Patience with anybody, if it's prejudiced or not, is something that everyone should have anyway.
So for me, throughout my life, I've gone through many situations where I've had, you know, bullying aspects and prejudice placed upon me. No fault of my own, but that's just what society decided to do. For me, a couple of years ago, though, after I graduated high school, for me, being a gay male in the city of New Bedford growing up, it was very difficult for me. I wasn't really in part of the in crowd. I wasn't, like, you know, really, really rich, and I really wasn't, you know, like, that poor. I was just kind of in the middle. But when I went to New Bedford High, especially even from Namanda Middle School on, there was always these subcultures. And for me, I never found that right niche in there. So, you know, I joined ROTC while I was in high school. That kind of helped me get some more bonding and some more friendship. But after I left, I looked back and I said, you know, there's really no support group here for LGBTQ youth that are in the area. So I got together with a couple other people in the community of New Bedford. We worked with Bagley, which is the Boston Alliance of Gay and Lesbian Youth, to help create a subchapter in New Bedford and Bagley to predominantly support and help and aid LGBTQ youth in the city of New Bedford. In this youth program that I was part of, that I helped found, I worked with a lot of youth, not just in the city of New Bedford, but Lakeville, Taunton, Attleboro, Fall River, Dartmouth. They traveled from the whole region of the South Coast pretty much to New Bedford for support and acceptance and understanding. And it was just a wonderful experience in there. I used my own personal experience of how I overcame things and pass that on to them to accept themselves first, because that's, it's you. You need to accept and love yourself first before others can really accept and love you. And with that motivation that I, you know, passed on to them, they've gone above and beyond of what I can imagine. I had a couple of those kids, well, youth, that were in that program that were ready to just drop out of high school. That was really on a downward spiral because one of our youth members committed suicide. And one of our busy years, and that took a lot of emotional strain on me and the fellow leaders, but we were able to pull up all these youth. We were actually able to provide support enough for these youth that they're actually in college now, something that they never really thought they were going to do. So just teaching others to accept and to love themselves, I would say, is the best way to help someone overcome prejudice.
I'd say number one overall, prejudice is eradicated through interaction. Say, for instance, I'm Cape Verdean and Portuguese. I'm mixed. I get a little bit of both. If I interact with someone of a Japanese descent or an Irish descent, I'm interacting, I'm exchanging cultures, ideas, religions, beliefs, practices. That was what eradicates prejudice. Because then it's like, oh, that misconception's wrong. Oh, that, well, that stereotype, that doesn't match them. Well, doesn't match him. That's what eliminates it.
I went to BCC, but I saw a dream club to help people to understand, like, disability. Because when I was in high school, when I was young, I always was the outsider. I always got picked on, I got bullied, people said I talk funny, and they never even joined the group. When I decided to go BC, I saw a dream club, so I hope everybody can understand the disability and how hard it could be. But I hope everybody can go together and we all can learn from each other.
Is racism, sexism, or any form of prejudice or discrimination taught? And if you feel so, where do you think it comes from?
I definitely think all of the above is taught. It's taught generation to generation, depending upon, you know, where people were brought up. The location plays a lot. You know, down south, you know, you see a lot more racism than maybe up north. I believe it has a lot to do with parenting, and I haven't had any children yet myself, but I will definitely teach tolerance. So it has to end somewhere. So I believe it goes a lot with the past generations and how they were brought up, and it's going to continue that way until it's, you know, eventually eradicated by people like us. So.
I have three small children. I have Levi, who's 6, and Shiloh, who's 5, and Violet, who's 3. And we have a diverse culture in our house. And I've never seen my 3-year-old be upset with someone for being Muslim, even though she knows that people go to different churches. I've never seen my 5-year-old be upset with her black grandmother or her Cape Verdean auntie. And I've never seen my 6-year-old be angry at anybody other than his sisters for taking his Pokemon cards. So I'm pretty sure it starts in homes and it starts really young. And it's really sad when I go to pick up my son and I see little snippets of sexism, little snippets of racism. And it breaks my heart because these children don't know anything other than what the people around them teach them. So I know BCC has a lot of parents, and I think every parent wants what's best for their child. And what's best for your child and my children is to learn tolerance and acceptance and peace from birth. And that truly is the only way to eradicate any of this. There was a quote when we made the signs for the march that I had wanted to include, but we ran out of signs. And it was, I should have just made another one. It was, if every 8-year-old is taught to meditate, I'm butchering this quote, but if every 8-year-old is taught to meditate, there will be no more violence in the world. And I think that that's absolutely true. It starts in the crib and it lasts for a lifetime.
Just like everyone else here on the panel, I think we're all in agreement that it is something that is taught. And because it is taught, it's actually rooted in our own cultures. Our society as a whole, even our race, each culture across the globe has some form of racism, sexism, something inside of it. And as bad as it is, that's just how the humanity itself has kind of gotten into this culture of communication. For me, I've experienced a lot. In New Bedford, we have a lot of subcultures there. You know, you have your Cape Verdeans, your Hispanics, you have the Portuguese. It's always been that big melting pot, and you can see that in the school. You can even see it in each little district and ward that you drive in. And as bad as it is, it's even in our education. You sit there and you're only taught so much about the key figures in history class, but you're not really taught, like, about Rosa Parks and Martin Luther King and Samuel like everyone else that's in the back of history. That I'm running out of names for history characters. Malcolm X and whatnot. But you don't really hear about these people in our class because it's not present. It's because it was taught before them, before their generation and generation before. And for me, I work at a hotel and I deal with a lot of people from many different cultures. And it's a local hotel and within this area. And I've met people all the way from Japan, South Korea, Australia, Germany, Canada, Mexico, everywhere that you can imagine so far. And I actually had a really bad interaction with one of my guests. They said, "Excuse me, sir, what type of hotel is this letting that type of person stay here?" And now, mind you, this type of person, they happen to be African American. And I was just appalled. I was just like, really? This is a public area. They are a guest just like you. They're paying money to be here just like you. And, you know, after a while, we started interacting and I found out it was something from their culture. Like, they didn't fully understand as they didn't have a lot of African Americans from their region. And, you know, at the end of the day, I hope I changed their mindset a little bit more so they became more aware and conscious of how they were thinking. But no, I definitely agree that it is something that is taught, like we've all said.
Could you name a form of discrimination you have faced or an act of violence you have dealt with in retrospect to prejudice?
So like I said, ageism is a big thing. Everyone looks at my age, 23 years old. Technically, I'm the on-site manager at my hotel property because no one works alongside me. I'm alone for 8 hours. So I control the hotel, and everyone just looks at me as I'm just a little kid. Like, I look young enough, and why am I here? I don't have the experience, but I've helped create a nonprofit. Work-wise, I've worked for the federal government, the state. I've worked for UMass Dartmouth itself. I've worked for the New Bedford Public School System. So when people look at my age, they discredit me for my experience and the experiences that I've held within my life or within work itself. My sexual orientation, I've had people discriminate against that. Even my height, my color of my eyes, my skin tone. I've had sexual assault done to me. I've experienced a lot of my life, but for me, that's helped me grow and better be a better person for myself.
I said earlier that I'm kind of an expert on sexual assault and domestic violence. When I was 17, I was raped by someone who I knew at my high school, and nobody stood up for me and nobody did anything for me, and I was told that it was my fault. And it was just going to happen again because that was just the type of girl I was. I was too friendly. And that was my first experience with anything sexual, and it was horrible. And it's not a story that I usually share in public, but it is something that my closest friends and my family knows. And when I talk about domestic violence and sexual assault, I talk about blame. And I talk about victim blaming and women shaming and feminism and sexism and all of these buzzwords that the internet kind of takes over and makes memes, and people don't really understand what those things mean. But as a grown woman who has been married and has 3 children and is improving my life by going to college, like all of you guys, I look back on that time and I think that if I didn't have my now husband at the time, and I didn't have my close friends at the time, I would have probably committed suicide because of how difficult that situation was for me. So when I hear, you know, on campus, or I see on Facebook, you know, things about, oh, short skirts, or, you know, what was she wearing, or things like that, it really angers me and it makes me upset. But I've taken that horrible experience and I've turned it into something really wonderful because I am really friendly, and I'll talk to anybody. And when I hear and see those things, I correct them on the spot. And I say, you know, it isn't her fault. It isn't his fault. It's the perpetrator's fault. And I think that that's probably, other than hello, how are you, one of the things that I've repeated most in my life is that it's not their fault. You're wrong. And I think that in that way, being able to turn that experience around and turn it into something positive through educating others. It's something that I've learned from and that I'm hopefully helping others to learn from as well.
That's very true, what you said. I think from my experience for discrimination, I think there's, you know, probably a lot of things that I don't even realize that I've been discriminated against, but I can definitely tell you that one of the things that I've been discriminated by is being a woman. Because a lot of jobs, let's be honest, men have the high culture and they're like, I can do this, they have the big ego going on. But what kills me the most is that I, as a woman, I can do anything pretty much as a man can do. And let me tell you, I'll be the first one to tell you that. And I'm sure that all you other women, you can do whatever a man can do too. But, you know, I went to do an internship at the New Bedford Police Department, and I had a couple officers. They were like, you wanna be an officer? They're like, do you think you got what it takes? And I'm like, yeah. They were like, you know, you kind of discriminated because I was a woman. They're like, oh, well, there's a lot of work and da 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 da. Well, guess what? I'm gonna become an officer. And when I wear that uniform, I'm gonna have that same conversation with you. So that is definitely one experience I can say. And it doesn't matter, female, male, don't matter. You are who you are, and you become who you want in this world. So I'm definitely gonna make it to the top this Sunday, I will. Another thing I would like to say is my race. I don't like when somebody discriminates against my race because I'm not just one thing. I have a diverse group. My mother, she's Cape Verdean and she's Cambodian. My dad is Italian, Portuguese, and he's French. And I don't like to be known as one thing. I get this probably 95% of my time in my life. Every time I apply for a job, I go for an interview. What's your race? What's your race? Oh, you're Portuguese? No, I'm not just one thing. And I don't like to be defined as one thing. I'm not just one color. And it shouldn't matter of what your race is. I think to me, it's important of what you can perform for that job. If you can do it and you have that profession and you have the skills and you have what it takes, then that's all that should matter. It shouldn't be what your race is to determine whether you can do that job or not, because let's be honest, you all can do anything and it doesn't matter what your race is. So I don't like to be described as one race because I'm many things. So it takes me a while to be like, oh, I'm this and I'm that. I'm not just one thing. So if that's one thing I've experienced in my life, it's definitely the races that I have going on. So I truly believe that you can do anything you want in your life and doesn't matter who you are.
Hi guys. When I tell you I got booty, but I didn't care because that made me actually stronger than who I am and made me a strong woman that I can actually go to college. A piece of email who have like a disability can do exactly the same thing what I can. Just be strong and you can do anything what you can do if you put your mind to it.
Unfortunately, in my life, I've dealt with a lot of bullying, especially in middle school, where I was first thinking about what I was truly and how to express myself. And God, the list goes on and on of all the violence that I've endured. I've been pushed downstairs. I have a cigarette burn behind my ear. I've almost been stabbed. I've had milk poured down my shirt. I've been locked in rooms. I've been called less of a woman because I identify as something that's non-binary. The list continues and it gets even sadder, but I won't continue because it might make me cry. But a lot of violence in my life, I find, has been procured by fear. Fear that people have of not knowing what I am, I guess. Not understanding, and fear then causes anger. They go hand in hand. And unfortunately, like Evie, I've had sexual assault in my life as well. And that also comes from being a woman, or when I identify as feminine, or when even when I identify as more masculine, people take it upon themselves to degrade me for that. But unfortunately, there is lots of violence in the world of things people don't understand.
It did take me a while to think about this because I was brought up by a good family, and I didn't really have to deal with racial prejudice or prejudice against women. I feel I was brought up a good way. So the only story I really have is recently. Core group of friends that I had ever since high school, which is a long time. I'm older than you probably think. I had to deal with them being prejudiced against an old friend that I had ever since I was about 10 years old. He hadn't been in my life for a while, and he came back, and they proceeded to make fun of him for how he looked, which was amazing to me because they weren't the best looking cats themselves. So one day it just got too far, and I handled it the wrong way, which I hope that if you ever have to deal with this, you'll handle it better. It did land me in the pokey in jail for a bit. I protected my friend's honor by, engaging with my best friend since high school. I felt that, nobody should persecute anybody, and I stood up for what I believed in. I did use violence, which wasn't the best choice, obviously. But at the time, it's what I did. And I feel that, you know, you should handle it better than I did, but I feel that you should still handle it. If you believe in something and you believe prejudice is wrong, you should take accountability for what you believe in and take it on, you know, head first. It doesn't matter if, you know, it's somebody that you've been friends with ever since you were 14 years old or it's somebody you just met. You should protect everybody because we're all people. We're all human beings.
In your generation, who do you feel has been the biggest advocate for peace?
Malala.
He's a little before my generation and my time, but definitely Harvey Milk. He was the start of the LGBTQ movement.
There's been a lot of people that I learned about throughout history. You know, Martin Luther King, Nelson Mandela, even Muhammad Ali, who was one of my heroes growing up. He fought for what he believed in by refusing to go to join the military and go through the draft, which he lost his boxing license for, but he did it because he didn't believe in violence in that manner. So there's a lot of people throughout history that I've learned about that I look up to personally and try to live my life the way they would.
Amy Blanchett.
All right, this will be the last question, and then we'll take some questions from the audience if anybody has them. Where is your sanctuary from the world, and how did you go about finding it?
For me, recently, my sanctuary for me is actually in my room on my gaming system. as nerdy as that sounds, I love gaming. It takes me to another place. It's another world. Each different game I put in, there's a different character in there. There's a different storyline. The graphics, there's always something new and amazing to see. And honestly, the gaming culture gets a lot of discredited for that. Like, it's too nerdy and whatnot. But just like a reader reads their books and falls in love with that storyline and those characters, that's just how gaming is, too. Like I said, every game you pick up, there's another story and another unique character. And it's just something, you know, our generation has grown up with, starting all the way back from our early childhood, like, you know, Pokemon, Red and White and whatnot. And I've moved up all the way since.
I go to Hogwarts. That's my real school. But honestly, I'm a total Harry Potter nerd. I really am. When Harry was 11 in 1997, when the books came out, I was 11. And then when Harry was 12, I was 12. And then when Harry was 14, I was 15. And it just kind of, I grew up with Harry. And I have all seven on my Nook. I have them all on my phone. I have them all on my Amazon account. I have them all. And that is one thing, is just escaping into my favorite book series. Or movies, or Tumblr, or I'm obsessed. or the other escape from the world is my kids and my husband. We live on the third floor of a three-floor building, and I disabled my doorbell. So if you really want to bother me, you have to climb all the way up those stairs. You'd be surprised how many people don't bother me. I just lock the door, and we play games, and we read books, and it's like a preschool, but the kids are really well-behaved because they're mine. And I just love it, and finding peace with my kids and my husband and my family and just locking that door and ignoring the world and shutting off the TV is the best place for me.
My game, I like to play a game that helped me calm down or just listen to music.
Well, if you can't tell by my wonderfully bright hair and charming way that I speak, I'm an artist. And I tend to lose myself in art and design, and art has always been my sanctuary. It's everything to me, and I couldn't live without it. It's something that I have to have. It's the air I breathe, and it's something that I've always been able to just lose myself in ever since I was a young kid dealing with other things. But another think that's my sanctuary. It's got to be my best friend, who's sitting right over there, Vanessa. She is my sanctuary, someone I can go to who will never judge me, and someone who will always be with me, and hopefully somebody that I can connect with forever.
Personally, myself, my sanctuary is any pool table. I love to play pool. It's where I can disconnect from the world, and it's just me pretty much playing myself, because anybody who plays pool knows that it's not the other guy you're playing yet. You only can beat yourself. It's only in your mind. So whenever things get too tough, I just go out and go play pool, and I can shut it all down and just enjoy myself.
I would say my sanctuary is yoga. Honestly, a good meditation is definitely well needed after a long day, 24-hour shift, and then a long day of school. So I think that yoga is the best sanctuary place for me to go. Puts me in a better place, and when I leave, my mood is completely turned around, and I forget why I was even mad. So that's my escape.
I'd say for me, mainly is art and music. Depending on the artist, a genre, it's a new feeling, it's a new experience, another story that's told. I just love art. It just expands your mind, thoughts, and art, just my escape.
Thank you, guys. I'm so proud of you. Our purpose with this panel today was to educate and inform students, staff, and faculty. You know, we have a diverse panel up here, and we wanted to address all forms of violence, all forms of prejudice, and just kind of open everybody's eyes up here, you know, that we're much more than, you know, just us walking around day-to-day in school and to and from class. We're people, and we all have been through some form of violence, some form of hatred, or prejudice, and I think it helps for us to talk about it. It helps for us to realize that we're not alone in things that we have gone through in our lives, and that there, you know, these, I'm sure every single one of you up here on the panel, if people came up to you and, you know, came to you with a problem that they've gone through in their past, like sexual assault or racism or orientation discrimination, I know for a fact every single one of you up here would be open to discussing with a student. So I can't thank you guys enough for being up here today. Some of you had short notice, and it was just greatly appreciated for you to be here. So can I have another round of applause for the panel? I would like to open this up quickly for some questions for the panel. If anyone has them, just raise your hand.
Can you see?
Yep.
So the question was, I'll repeat for the camera, how do you all feel about the current status of the election in this country?
For me, I will say I haven't seen any true leadership going on. I've always been in a position of leadership, and with everything that's going on, just as politics is politics, it's the cat battle pretty much. Everyone's just punching each other, beating each other up as best as they can so that they can be in first place. And I don't really think that's what it should be about. We are in a crucial point in history right now. This is the 21st century. 2020 is only 4 years down the road. And by now, where are those flying cars? Like, that's where our future should be going. We should be focusing on education. We should be focusing on our tourism industry. We should be focusing on our relationships with the other countries. We should be trying to land on Mars tomorrow and not 10 years from now. And I just think all of this political hoorah that's going on is just nonsense. And I don't see a true leader at this point.
This is, I hate to age myself, this will be my third time voting in a presidential election. And the first two times I voted for Barack Obama, and if I could vote for him again, I would, but I can't, so I'm gonna write him in anyway. But like I said earlier, I like to focus on the positive. And one of the things that I love about living in Massachusetts is that generally we're a pretty liberal state. And so a lot of our state laws and a lot of our state representatives and our state senators are pretty good and represent us well. So when I see buffoons on the news with their Islamophobic rhetoric and their racism and their craziness, I just turn it off and try and focus on my own community and my own life and what I can do on a small scale. Because at the end of the day, the person who becomes president is really a figurehead, and there are a lot of other people that are up for re-election that we could essentially get out of office and change the current of the country and the way the country is led without needing the president to be whoever you want him to be, or her to be. Maybe it'll be a her this time, I don't know. But yeah, there's always write-ins, so.
I try to stay neutral on the topic of politics as much as possible, just to have an open understanding with everybody and to respect everybody's decision on who they vote for. But I will say this, there's one person who is winning right now who I can tell you will not make the world, America, the entire world, a better place. This person has been abusive towards women, abusive towards other races, is a bigot and is a racist individual, and I am very sad that this person is winning the race right now.
Personally, I don't like politics. Sorry, my teacher over there. But I don't know. Ever since I can remember, you know, with the voting and everything, I've never really been too into it because I've heard too much, once again, stupidity on the subject. You know, we have to vote for the black guy. We have to vote for the woman because it's going to be the first woman. I hear that a lot, and I'm like, you can't vote for people upon just those things alone. Like, somebody I know personally is always like, oh, I want the first woman president. It's like, do you know anything about what she believes in or what she's going for? No. I want the first woman. It's about that a lot, I feel, these days. So it is kind of a joke to see what's going on. And hopefully, you know, we can sort through all the BS and choose who should be the president, not based upon their, you know, the color of their skin, whether they're male or female, the haircut they have. So yeah, hopefully we pick the right one.
Thank you. We have another question. Yes, Stephen.
Mr. Thomas, when you keep silence, a lot of things can happen. For example, when Nazi Germany start throwing out Jews and burning their houses and taking away the properties, German people stayed back and did not say a word. You have suffered. We don't talk very much. We keep everything inside. Women suffering with problems at home, they don't talk. Your friends are being abused. You see that? You don't talk. My question to you, now that you're here and you have told us your story, would you speak up a little bit more when you see something like that or know something like that?
The answer to your question, Steve, yes. It's very important for us students, especially because you're in college now, you're not in high school, and you have to teach the younger, the youth, that it's important to stick up to not only what you believe in, but to stick up for the next person beside them, because the next person beside you might be weaker and you might be their strength. So I definitely believe that it should be emphasized to tell people that it's okay to stick up for this person, but we have to teach people to stick up for themselves as well. So I definitely think that the more you emphasize it, the more you make it broad, the more people who will get less traumatized from that. So I only hope that we do better as students.
In my personal opinion, silence is weakness. Silence is fear, and fear can turn into anger, and anger turns into violence. So the more you speak out about something, the more peace you can spread, and the more you can change. The more silent you are, the more you are passive to the violence that occurs in the world. As you said about Nazi Germany and how the Germans stayed silent during these terrible times, in psychology there's a term called groupthink, where it's something that happens where if somebody has enough power in their voice and encouragement to the people, those people will also follow into that way of thinking, almost as if they're just they're conforming to that way of thinking in themselves. And by them being silent, that basically set them up for the violence of the country, in my opinion. But specifically, we shouldn't be silent if we know something is going wrong. We shouldn't be silent if somebody on the street gets mugged. We should fight for anything we believe in.
This is kind of one of the questions that I hope somebody would have asked, because I was going to elaborate on some of the questions that I read earlier, and I was looking forward to talking about them. But all this talk about peace and can there be peace, there's never going to be peace ever in the world. The history of the world has always had violence between cultures ever since, you know, the caveman fighting over, you know, who's going to get the meat. You know, there's always going to be violence and fighting. So it does, you know, come down to us and the future generations. You know, if it wasn't for people standing up, there would be, you know, women would still be in the kitchen and not in the workforce. There'd still be African Americans, you know, working in the fields. There'd still be Irish people farming potatoes. There's somebody that stands up in each of these situations that is the first person to fight for what they believe in. Rosa Parks didn't want to sit in the back of the bus, and she fought for what she believed in. Martin Luther King fought for what he believed in. And, you know, each generation comes up with this person that has the ability to do something. And, you know, just from what I've brought up to believe, especially in the military, is it doesn't matter the color of your skin. It doesn't matter if you're white, black, if you're a woman or you're male. You know, you rely on the person next to you. And with all the trials and tribulations of the world going on now, you know, all the countries at war, you know, it really comes down to we're Americans, and each person is the same on the inside. So until we can start to group together and work together, you know, that, you know, there's never going to be peace. So I think that's where we kind of need to start. We need to stand up and not hold it in. We need to fight for what we believe in and for what's right.
Every year, BCC, the Student Senate, participates in the It's On Us campaign, which is about keeping sexual assault and violence off of college campuses. It's a nationwide campaign brought forth by the Obama administration. And it's something that I'm really proud to be a part of as a sexual assault survivor. And one of the things, I think Bruce and I got into a little bit of a debate earlier in the year about what can you really do to stop sexual violence? What can you really do to cause peace? And one of the things that I'm a certified nurse aide in a nursing home. I'm a mandated reporter of abuse and neglect. And one of the things I think I said was that everybody should be a mandated reporter, not just teachers, not just social workers, not just nurses and medical staff. Everybody is a mandated reporter, because when you have been sexually assaulted, when you are being bullied, when you are facing a group think against you in the form of any kind of violence or prejudice, you lose your voice. Most of the time, when beaten down enough, people will lose their own voice. And I think that as a human family and as a college campus and as one people, we need to look out for those that don't have a voice, whether it be because they've lost it through abuse or neglect, or whether it be because they are just stunned by the violence that's being perpetrated on them. So I think that standing up and speaking out and being the voice for the silenced is probably the most important thing that we can do.
I'd say it's crucial to speak on any injustice, because in return, who's gonna speak on your behalf? It's always by one person, one comment, that starts a conversation, that starts a movement, that starts the battle with peace that we always have.
I'll just kind of branch off of what you just said, and as like Amy said, this is what the purpose of this forum was for. This was to open up the discussion, to no longer sit here and be silent, to actually bring it forth to the public spotlight, in which society tends to put it back behind closed doors. And standing up and actually being open and speaking about this, it's a big form of courage. Each of us up here are showing and emphasizing our own personal courage to be able to talk about the personal experiences that we've been through. And just because of that, we're hopefully reaching out to everyone that's been listening today to open up their mind so that they no longer sit silent and that they will speak up to continue the pattern on and on.
Is there any more questions? Yes, Daniel?
I'd like to thank everyone for this opportunity today, but there is a question I do have, though. But first, there's scientific studies that do prove if people at the same time do mass meditations, it actually, once in Washington, D.C., it was proven it actually brought down world violence roughly 72% that day. So I would actually like to open up an invitation to BCC if we could conduct a mass meditation, which could have a similar effect.
I think that's a great idea. What do you guys think?
Great idea.
Of course, Victoria loves that idea.
I love that idea. I think that would be a great thing for everyone at BCC to participate in, even if it's not everybody, a certain certain times, such as finals week. I think that would be a great time for everyone, and it would reduce a lot of anxiety, and like Evie was saying, anxiety for her is terrible, and anxiety for me is terrible too, so that would be an amazing idea to do.
I don't know if I'd partake personally, but I do believe it's a good idea. I'm not one for the whole meditation thing. I'm sorry, it's just not my thing. I'd also like to say, if anybody has a problem with prejudice in BCC's community or in the other communities, just come to me. I'll take care of it. Personally.
I don't know.
I'll do it. I'm not scared. I can be Batman.
I also agree about that. That'd be a good idea. And if we could, we could have all the club to do it as well.
If you guys have any awesome ideas like that, the Student Senate office is right there. And we have the Student Senate Facebook page as well. You can message us. The Student Senate does put on a finals week event on each of the campuses where some campuses have therapy dogs that come in. So those campuses are very lucky. We're working on that for Fall River, hopefully. And other events, other activities, free snacks and stuff to help calm everybody down during finals and midterms and stuff like that. So I feel like maybe we should talk about that today at our Student Senate meeting, maybe having a yoga meditation moment. But you know, you guys should have come to our peace march today, because it wasn't very peaceful, but we got our point across.
And I think Daniel should be on that committee.
Volunteer.
We're gonna give you some work. But I love the idea. Is there any more questions in the audience before we end? Yes, Vanessa? He's coming over with the mic.
there was a question. Some cases, though, especially if it's domestic violence or if, say, the friend is dealing with some harm or suicidal situation, the situation can be delicate. Or if it's sexual assault, do you guys have advice or know how you would handle that situation?
Well, the victim's privacy or the person's privacy and their initial safety is the most important thing. So if you know someone who is suicidal or you know someone who is threatening self-harm, the first thing you do is get them emergency services, and then social services and counseling goes after that. But if someone, if a friend just comes to you and says, you know, my boyfriend is pressuring me into doing this activity, or, you know, something happened, you know, you first be a listener and actively listen the way Chris was talking about earlier, and then you can go from there. And to bring it back to a little bit of politics, which we were talking about before, one of the reasons it's so important to vote is because the people that you vote for determine funding for social programs and determine funding for low-income people who are experiencing self-harm and counseling services. And they determine how much money and how many social workers and how many therapists and how much Medicaid and Medicare money will go to helping people who need that help. So like I said, the first thing is to get someone who's in an emergent situation emergency help. And then the second thing is to always be an active listener. And then wherever you go, especially in Massachusetts and especially at BCC, there's counseling services and there's help. And you can look for it. And we actually have pamphlets. The Student Senate has pamphlets that someone in the community made for people who are at risk for a ton of different things. There's a list of every social service. There's a list of every food pantry. There's pamphlets like that all over the campus. So if you need help, you can reach out to someone on campus. You can reach out to a friend. Google is your friend. You can find the resources to help your friends.
I totally agree everything that Evie just said. For me, though, I feel as there's always, I'll stand up for you. There's always a proper time and place. What I mean by that is evaluate the situation. Like Evie said, if it's an emergency, definitely contact the emergency services. But make sure, depending on what the situation is or what the individual is going through, make sure you use the proper time and place, because sometimes you address it at the wrong time in the wrong place, and it makes the thing a lot more difficult and makes the situation bigger than it needs to be. And then also, I do know firsthand, a lot of people don't like to provide help because they don't know where to go or what to do in that situation. And remember, if you don't know, that's all right. Ask someone. And just by asking, you can find that help. You can go to the student life office, you can go to your professor, you can go to an administrative person, you can just go to your parents, someone. As long as you're reaching out to help another person, that's always the greatest and best step that you can do.
To add a quick note to what Chris just said, sometimes no matter how many times you help somebody or offer to help somebody, they don't take it. And it's frustrating, especially like Amy and I work a lot with domestic violence cases, and there are a lot of women and families and men who go back to their abuser and go back to their abuser and go back to their abuser. And that's very frustrating, but you always have to respect that if someone doesn't want help and won't accept help, then there's nothing else you can do but just be their friend and be there for them, and, you know, keep your phone on. And sometimes that's the only thing that you can do, and you can't internalize that and you can't feel guilty about that because they are making a choice. It's a really difficult situation to be in. There's a huge addiction problem in this part of the country right now, but you can't feel guilty if someone won't take the help you're offering. All you can do is offer it.
Especially in high school, I've lost a lot of friends to self-harm and suicide, and I find that the best way to deal with somebody that's hurting is to listen, like Evie said, and to be understanding. And if somebody doesn't want help, there's nothing that you can do to stop them from doing the things that they're doing. And you can't pressure them into getting help either, because that just makes things a lot worse. Even in situations such as domestic violence, unfortunately, you can't force somebody to get better, and you can't force somebody into getting help from a therapist, because sometimes that just leads them into doing more harm to themselves or getting deeper into a terrible relationship and getting domestic violence put upon them. So be understanding, listen, and don't pressure somebody to get help, even if you think it's the best thing for them to do.
I'm just going to add to what they all just said. I agree with all of you, especially even Caroline. You have to respect. You can't push someone, because you can push them and you can push them right over the edge. I have a club here on campus. It's called the BCC Coalition Against Domestic Violence. Woo! I am the president. Evie is the secretary. I have a few other student senate members that were here earlier that are also members. So Sarah, that's in the admissions office over there. I see you. She's a member too. And we are all former, I don't like to say victims, survivors of domestic violence or sexual assault, so we have experience with it firsthand. And we love nothing more than to talk directly and personally with other people who have been affected or are going through that situation currently and try to help you as much as possible. That's something, you know, that is a cause for us that's extremely important and close to heart. So anytime you need to talk, we're here. You can email any one of us. We have a Facebook page, BCC Coalition Against Domestic Violence. We meet once a month. I have a clothesline project that's coming up on April 14th. We've always had the clothesline project here at BCC, but it has been moved from place to place. It was from the Women's Center in New Bedford. We currently do not have our own. So this year, students on campus are going to make their own t-shirts to be hung on the clothesline, which will stay here. And it will be a visual representation of what domestic violence and sexual assault is to you, how you feel others perceive it. It can be a victim who has passed on. A family member could make the shirt to represent a family member that has passed on. We have children that make the shirts too, which is a real powerful statement. So again, this is something that's really important to me and to us. So I hope that you can come. That's April 14th. It'll be here in the G building in the lobby from 10 to 2. At 1:30, we'll also have the Katie Brown Educational Program come in. They'll be in the G building inside the atrium, and they will have a presentation that they'll put on. The Katie Brown Foundation is an excellent, excellent program. They actually go out into schools as early as elementary school and start speaking with them about bullying, about sexual assault, domestic violence, self-harm, self-respect. They're just an amazing program, and they've recently branched out to colleges to talk about sexual assault and domestic violence, because it's just such an important and prevalent issue here, especially here in the South Coast. You'd be surprised with how many cases, sadly, currently we have. So I hope that you can join us. Anybody who wants to make a shirt is more than welcome. We'll have tables set up, and you can come by at any point from 10 to 2 and make a shirt. Thank you. Any other questions? All right, we're gonna end here. I would like to have another round of applause for our fabulous panel.